Looking in Acts chapter 1 and 2 in just a few minutes, hopefully. A number of years ago, a movie came out that was written, directed, produced, and financed by Robert Duvall. And it was called The Apostle. Actually, one of my very, very favorite movies. It was a story about a Pentecostal pastor who had messed his life up and decided to leave Texas and go to Louisiana and start over. He had rededicated his life to the Lord and was on his way to Louisiana, and all along the way he would make these stops, and one of them he just was going by a bar, and he goes up in the bar and grabs a man out of the bar, brings him outside, and said, "Now don't you go back up in there anymore. You just go down the street here, got on Holy Ghost power." And the man didn't know what else to say, so he started going down the street hot on Holy Ghost power. It's mighty strange, if you think about it for a moment, you'll find out it's really not. Because that is where the power comes from. That is where the power for us to do anything comes from, is plain old Holy Ghost power. Most churches today are terrified of the Holy Ghost. They're scared to death of him. They don't want anything to do with him because it puts them in an uncomfortable position to where they have to admit to the supernatural power of God. And according to most of these perpendicular icicles, that went away centuries ago and there is no such thing as that. They'll tell you that. A church this week over to the next city over from Lynchburg, and I'm not going to make mention of the name of the dead. They ran an ad on Facebook and they said, "For the first time in over a year, we're going to open our church. And you need to sit apart from everybody and bring your face covering because we're going to celebrate Pentecost." I wrote to him and I said, "Can you not taste the irony here?" Nobody would reply to me. They acted like I didn't put anything on there, but I know they read it. Can you not taste the irony? We claim we trust Jesus with our soul. Well, why in the dickens can't you trust him with your body? Is it, are we that unbelieving? Come on, people. Either you trust him or you don't. We got to think hard about that because the world is watching us. But I will tell you what the problem is, why individuals and all are cowering even this morning and living in fear and won't boldly come before the Lord and won't worship together, is there is no Holy Ghost power in their lives. That's a fact. That is the truth. Jesus told them in Acts chapter 1 he had died and been buried and had risen from the dead. And then in verse 4, they were being assembled together with him. He commanded that they should not, he's telling the apostles now, that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, "You have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now." Made all the difference in the world. Prior to that, the Apostle Peter, who would one day become the mouth of the church. We got three or four of them in here. I'm not sure who'd get that vote. Before that, he was running, he was hiding, he was swearing, he was cursing, and said, "I don't know the man." But now something's going to be different that's going to change him, and that's going to be Holy Ghost power. Jesus said, "For you will receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me in both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth." When you get filled with the Holy Ghost, you have boldness to witness. You're not afraid of the devil himself.
That's right.
You will stand in the face of anything and tell them about Jesus. You'll stand up to them. What do you think David got? Where do you think he got his power from when he was a little teenage boy and he went up against a 9'6", 575-pound man covered with armor and beat him? That was Holy Ghost power. That's all that was. Look at all of the great things that people were able to do, and even of late, and they all did it with Holy Ghost power. We see the fulfillment of it 50 days after Jesus rose from the dead. It was a famous Jewish celebration that we call Pentecost. It was a celebration of the giving of the law. It was a celebration of the first fruits that people grew in their crops. And it was also called the Feast of Weeks, and it was a very, very important Jewish feast. But on that day, we were given something from God called the Holy Ghost. Amen. And the world has never been the same since that day. Listen to this, chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. That's the first requirement for a church receiving that kind of power. They've got to be in one accord. You can't have people on these pews with one agenda and one sitting over here with another agenda and then one over here and they're all looking at each other and taking pot shots with each other and all that. No, you've got to come together as one, as a family with the same goals, and that goal ought to be lifting one another up and reaching souls for Christ. And when you do that, the Holy Ghost can do His work in your life. But while you're sitting there sulking, pouting, getting all puffed up, getting mad because you didn't get your way or you didn't get this or you didn't get that this week, He can't do nothing with you. It's time that we get right with the Lord first. That's one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. Oh, to see the Holy Ghost fill the house where we were sitting one more time. Man, that's what the churches need. They don't need any more programs, and they don't need any more finances, and they don't need it. They need the Holy Ghost to fill their house when they get together to meet. That's what they need. There appeared unto them cloven tongues. Everybody getting uncomfortable yet? In a Baptist church, man, I'm going to let you have it good this morning. About time that Baptists learn that the Holy Ghost is real and that He imparts gifts, supernatural gifts to people. I got fretted one time and told Pastor Boley, maybe we ought to change the name. He said, no, brother, let's show the world what a Baptist church is supposed to be. So we kept that name, and that's what we're going to do. Now, there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. That's what we need. We need a filling. And the only way you can get a filling of the Holy Ghost is to get your stubborn self out of the way. Once you put your flesh aside and let God take control, He can fill you. But He can't fill you when it's full of ridiculous foolishness and pride. So you've got to empty yourself. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now let me show you how that works. There's a lot of imitating of that today in churches. And anytime you hear people imitating a gift of God, you got to remember there's a real thing somewhere that is actually being practiced. And it's going to explain what these tongues or languages were as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. There were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men of every nation under heaven. According to Hebrew law, you had to show up to Jerusalem to celebrate the harvest, the Feast of Weeks, every year. And so here they come, right on time as God said it. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together to see what these apostles were doing. And they were confounded because every man heard them speak in his own language. It's like me up here talking in English, but one over here is hearing it in Spanish, one of them is hearing something in German, one of them over here is hearing the same thing in Swahili. That's the miracle. That's what that was. A pastor friend of mine who has gone on to be with the Lord now was a mentor of mine. I would go to him privately when I first got into ministry, and he helped me and he coached me and he taught me and he prayed for me. And he was a powerful, powerful man of God. And he had to have some serious heart surgery one time and had to go to UVA to do it. And it was the kind of thing where they had to put him in like some kind of a water bath or some kind of an ice bath or something. I never did understand it, but it was a very strange surgery. And they brought a number of surgeons in, and four of them were from different countries. Oriental, Philippines, something else. It was four different countries. They were foreign doctors. And while they had him cut open, while they were operating on his heart, he spoke while he was under anesthesia, and it scared those doctors to death. But they listened to what he said, and he does not even remember any of it because he was under. And they all went home and thought about what it was he said. And they, when they finally got over being stunned, they came back to the hospital and said, I heard him speaking fluent Filipino language or Spanish to me. And another one said, no. I heard him speaking in German to me. And it disturbed them so bad that two of them got saved. He gave them the gospel while he was under. This is no fairy tale. This is the truth. I've known this man ever since 1980. And everybody that knows him knows he was telling the truth. And he even had it documented if anybody wanted to see where the doctors wrote what they heard. That's the miracle. And it said they were all amazed and marveled, saying, are not all of these men that we hear speaking, are they not Galileans? In other words, are they not from Hogtown? And how do we hear every man in our own dialect where we were born? These men are from Galilee, but we're hearing it in our dialect. And this is the dialects that they heard it in. The Parthians, the Medes, the Elamites, and dwellers in Mesopotamia, and Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, and Egypt, and the parts of Libya about Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians. We do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. That was the miracle of Pentecost, was not in the speaking, but in the hearing. A lot of people don't think of that. One time many years ago, many of you know who Jack Hiles is. He was Mr. Independent Fundamentalist Separatist Baptist. He had this large church out in, I think it was Hammond, Indiana. In a Sunday night service, a Chinese woman walked in the service looking utterly bewildered, looking very convicted, and looking very upset. One of the greeters met her and brought her to one of his prayer warriors. I like that term. And he could not speak with her. She could not speak one lick of English. And of course, he couldn't speak any Chinese. And he wanted so bad to minister to her. But he did not know what to do. And so he went up to the pastor during the service and said, I got a Chinese woman down here. And she looks like she's under conviction, but nobody in here can talk to her. What must I do? And like any good pastor, well, you just go down there and pray and do the best you can. Well, he did. And for 10 minutes, he spoke fluent Chinese to that woman, led her to the Lord right in front of everybody. And as soon as she accepted the Lord as her Savior, God cut him off and he couldn't speak another word of it, didn't even know what he'd said to her. But he did while he was talking to her. Don't tell me that God can't still do that through the Holy Ghost and the Holy Ghost power. Don't ever tell me he can't. Yeah, people need to start learning that these things are real and they're still valid today. All of it. And said these men were all amazed and were in doubt, saying, "What does this mean?" And some people standing by made light of it and said, "These men are full of new wine." But here's Peter the apostle, a different man now. This man now is full of the Holy Ghost, and he's not running and hiding and denying and swearing and cursing. He is standing up before a huge crowd of thousands of people, and he's getting ready to tell it like it is. All because of Holy Ghost power. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice. That means he was loud. And he said unto them, "You men of Judea, and all you that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and listen to my words, for these are not drunken, seeing that it's only 9 o'clock in the morning." Because he knew that they would understand that nobody got drunk at 9 o'clock in the morning. At least back then they didn't. I understand a lot of y'all get an early start now. But you know what he was talking about. He said, "But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel." And the prophet Joel told that in the future, things would change. It would literally upset the apple cart of religion. This religiosity that people have, and this opinion of what God should be. And for centuries, people have put God in a box, and they've told God, "You can do this and you can do that, but you can't do this anymore, because our professors at the seminary have told us that you can't do this anymore." Oh, that's a challenge when God hears that, because he's going to show you what he can do anymore. He's going to show you. He said this, Prophet Joel, "And it shall come to pass in the last days." And what happened there was a hint of what the last days are going to look like. And we're getting ready to see it again, because this is the last days. He said, "It shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall preach." Ooh! That was painful, wasn't it? Babylon Bee had the funniest picture that I've ever seen, that a Baptist church had a trap door behind the pulpit to open up whenever a woman got behind it, and it showed her going on down through the pulpit. And that's one of the bugaboos that has people scared plumb to death. Heaven forbid that a woman would preach the word of God. When somebody said on Facebook that y'all don't mind looking and listening to a cartoon tomato preach, but you have a fit when a woman does. Learn your church history and you'll find out that a woman can preach. And quite frankly, a little bit better than half of us men can. I'm hanging on in case that trap door opens down here, because it'll take me too. I got a good grip on this pulpit. "Your sons and your daughters will prophesy," and that word is translated "preach." "And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." I'm hearing of that every single day now, that God is coming to people in dreams and visions and dealing with them over and over and over again, and they're seeing things and they're all agreeing on the same thing. "And on my servants and on my handmaidens," there you go again, "I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor and smoke." Those are things that will be seen in the tribulation which is getting ready to come upon us. "The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before that great and notable day of the Lord shall come." And here's the good news. Because of the coming of the Holy Ghost and because of the power of the Holy Ghost, that it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. That's the bottom line. It's open to Gentiles and Jews and heathens and people who think they're okay and everything like that. You just need to realize you're a wretched lost sinner without him, and you call upon the name of the Lord and you will be saved. Amen. You men of Israel, hear these words. Now here is a man that at one time was hiding. You notice that when Jesus had died, that the apostles were hiding for fear of the Roman soldiers and fear of the Jews. Just like the church of today, hiding at home from a virus. Might as well tell it. There are people petrified and scared to death, so desperate to hang on to this earthly life that they ain't given a hoot about their heavenly life. You get full of the Holy Ghost and you'll get out of your house and you're not going to be afraid of no bug. I don't care how bad it is. So what if you die from it? Paul said, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. We need to quit worrying about this life. My goodness. Here's Peter. You men of Israel, hear this. Jesus of Nazareth, the man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves know, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, you have taken and by wicked hands crucified and slain. That took guts to say that, because they could have stoned him to death at any moment for making that kind of accusation, but he didn't care. Whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it wasn't possible that he should be holden of it. For David spoke concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh shall rest in hope, because you will not leave my soul in hell, neither will you suffer your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life and shall make me full of joy with thy countenance. Peter was quoting David in a prophecy. Then he told them this, men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulcher is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his loins, according to his flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne, the throne of David. He, seeing this before, he spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we're all witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this which you now see and you now hear. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, the Lord said to my Lord, sit on my right hand, until I make thy foes thy footstool. Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom you have crucified both Lord and Christ. A different St. Peter stood there and said, y'all are responsible for the crucifixion of Christ. And he told it just like it was. He didn't sugarcoat anything. He preached a hard, strong message, because he had the Holy Ghost backing him this time. And listen to this. When the people heard it, they were pricked in their heart. And they said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, then, what shall we do? What a wonderful thing for someone to come to you after you have witnessed under the power of the Holy Ghost, and they go, what should I do? And he told them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, unto the remission of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And it went on to say, and then it concludes with, then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. That's what the Holy Ghost will do. He will add to your church. He will give you power to witness, power to preach. And I might add, he'll give that power to anyone that walks with him and serves him and is faithful and believing. You don't have to worry. God can use you no matter who you are, no matter where you are. You just let him do it. But you can't do anything for God. No matter what kind of money you got, no matter what kind of talent you got, unless you are filled with the Holy Ghost. That's the bottom line. Because it is not you that ministers, it is him. I'm just going to be honest with you. Without the power of the Holy Ghost, I'm nothing more than a babbling idiot. You may think I'm that already, and that's okay. But I might be a nut, but I'm screwed on to a good bolt. And that's the power of the Holy Ghost. I tried to write something all day. Sat down last night. I couldn't come up with no notes to put down at all. I even got in here this morning, opened my Bible, and got ready to write on a piece of paper, and it just everything went blank. Because God said, I'm going to do this, not you. You're not going to do this. And he will use you like that too. He will give you a mouth to speak the same hour, and he'll give you the message that he wants you to speak. Quit worrying about whether or not you got all your time in looking at this and all that. If you know the Word of God and if you've read the Word of God, he'll tell you what to say. The whole, the one thing you need to do to get prepared is you let the Holy Ghost lead and then you start reading this. The message will come when it is necessary. Don't you worry about that. But I've seen him do all kinds of incredible things. I've seen him heal. I've seen him give people strength and power and wisdom and all kinds of wonderful supernatural gifts. But you've got to trust him. You've got to believe that he will do that and that he can do the same thing for you today that he did in the book of Acts. The book of Acts was not written for story time. It was a manual of how the early church did things and how we're supposed to do things. Right. Nothing has changed. And when the church starts living like the book of Acts, you will see the evil people in this nation fleeing to get across the river. You will see them running as fast as they can. Because when America's churches have the power, then the evil can do nothing. The evil people can do absolutely nothing. My mother went to a very, very powerful church back in the 30s and 40s. And it was called Greenstone Christian Tabernacle. It wasn't even a Baptist church. It was a Disciples of Christ church. The pastor was Brother Tommy Flowers. Anybody that's lived here over 60 years know who I'm talking about.